The next item on the order paper is a motion on economic strategy. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour, 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the Marshall list. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly calls on the Executive to focus on creating more and better jobs in Northern Ireland and to bring forward an updated economic strategy alongside the new programme for Government 2016-21.
I call Gordon Lyons to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker, and can I take this opportunity to welcome you to your new role and to wish you well in it. I'm delighted to be able to bring this motion to the House, the first private member's motion that I have brought to the Chamber. And I think it's important to note that it is on the issue of creating more and better jobs for people in Northern Ireland. You will all be aware of our five-point plan that we went to the electorate with over the course of the election campaign, and of course we received a very large endorsement from the electorate and we received a mandate, and I'm very pleased to be able to bring this issue to the floor of the Assembly today. Jobs, of course, are incredibly important. Jobs are of huge importance here in Northern Ireland and for the future prosperity of Northern Ireland. Jobs, of course, are important as well to the local economy and the different areas in which we represent. High employment is good for the economy overall, but jobs are obviously hugely important to individuals as well, important for their own economic prosperity, but also very important in terms of their general health and indeed their mental health as well. And studies have shown that unemployment means that you're more prone to having poorer general health and poorer mental health. So it is important that we focus on this issue. It is important that we give the issue the time and attention that it deserves. That's why we have brought the motion to the House today. And I know that we have already discussed this issue in part yesterday, but it does us no harm to talk about it again and to focus specifically on the issue of jobs and then, of course, on the wider economic strategy. I stand here this afternoon very, very pleased and very proud with the record of the Executive in the last mandate. You only have to look at some of the targets that were set 5 years ago and see how they have been achieved, and we can say there has been real success. When you set out with a plan to create 25,000 jobs and you create 40,000 jobs, you can't call that a failure. Whenever you say you want to attract £1 billion worth of investment and you attract £3 billion worth of investment, you can't call that a failure. Whenever you say you want to get £300 million of investment in research and development and we manage to get £585 million, you can't call that a failure. When you look at the payment, the salaries in terms of some of these jobs, and how much higher than so many of them are in comparison to the Northern Ireland average, that is something that we should welcome. And if you want to look at the most important figure of all, leaving all of those things to the side if you wish, take the unemployment rate in Northern Ireland. It has gone down from 60,000 in 2011 to under 40,000 today. That is something that we should be pleased with, that is something that we should be proud of, but we need to keep working. We don't rest. And I'm particularly pleased that in my own constituency, unemployment has fallen by a third over the last 5 years. As I said yesterday, these aren't just numbers, these are real people who have benefited as a result of the actions that the last executive has taken and that I hope that this current executive will take as well. I think one of the major successes as well of the last number of years has been the devolution of corporation tax powers. That will be hugely beneficial to our economy as long as we are bringing in the skills that are necessary as well for our young people in particular. So we have had successes, but we cannot rest. We need to keep progressing. And that's why we're calling today for the Minister to and the Executive to bring forward an updated economic strategy. If I could spend just a little bit of time, Mr. Deputy Speaker, outlining some of the things I would like to see included in that strategy. I think the first thing, something I hope everybody in the House will want to see, is a rebalancing of the economy. We know that we are heavily dependent upon the public sector in Northern Ireland. We want to change that. We want to grow our private sector. We want to see more people employed in the private sector. And we want to see more people with jobs and higher incomes as well. As I've already said, we need to focus on the skills of our people and ensuring that our people have the skills that are necessary in order for them to succeed in the workforce. We're in a new economy compared to where we were even 20 years ago, never mind 50 years ago. So we need to ensure that our people have the skills and the talents in order to succeed. I am well aware, and other members will be well aware, of how jobs can now be so easily exported to other parts of the world, especially those jobs which we perhaps depended upon in the past. And so it's important that we have the best skilled and the best trained people. And on that point, certainly will give way.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. Would the member agree with me that one of the great achievements of the last executive, an executive whose legacy we heard being disrespected and challenged yesterday in the House, was the decision to freeze university tuition fees and thereby helping to contribute to stopping the brain drain of talent out of Northern Ireland and keeping our most talented young people here to contribute to our economy?
Absolutely. I completely agree with my colleague from South Belfast, and that is going to be key in the future, that we ensure that we keep people here. And I think we all want to see that. We want to see our young people. Sorry, I can't give way. I don't think I'm getting any extra time, but hopefully we'll be able to hear from the member later on. So we want to see competitiveness as well as increasing the skills of our workforce. And we want to give support as well, I hope, in this economic strategy for some of our smaller businesses and giving them the help that they need to grow and to become larger businesses as well. If I could briefly mention the importance of infrastructure as well. We have been very fortunate in the last mandate in East Antrim to have seen the construction of two new roads, the A8 to Larne and the A2 to Carrickfergus, both from Belfast, and local employers have said that has been hugely beneficial to them and that there is added potential there which we hope to exploit into the future as well. Can I also ask the Minister to look into the issue of broadband? I know that members from across the House will also want to make sure that issue is addressed. This isn't just for homes, but also, for example, there is a business park in my constituency that would love access to higher speed broadband, and we hope that there will be measures within the economic strategy that will address that issue. If I could turn now to the amendment in the name of Mr. Eastwood. We certainly will not be opposing the amendment that he has brought to the House today. In many ways, it's perhaps just another way of saying what we have already said, insofar as the member talks about high-value, high-skilled and better-paid jobs. I'd like to think that's somewhere much the same as more and better-paid jobs that we have outlined in our original motion, and we certainly don't disagree with that at all. We share that goal. We want to see that happen. And in government, our party will certainly be working to ensure that that happens through our economic strategy. The member also mentions at the end of his motion about the need for a regionally balanced economy, and I certainly share that aspiration. That's something that we want to see happen. We don't want to see all the jobs concentrated in one place. But I hope that the member will understand that we do need a degree of realism in all of this as well, that we can't have a perfectly balanced spread of jobs, that naturally some jobs will go to certain places. I think we had a debate in this chamber the last mandate, and some members were bemoaning the lack of jobs in North and West Belfast compared to South and East. And I think one of the reasons why there were so many jobs in East and South instead of North and West is because of, for example, the Harbour Estate in East Belfast and the city centre obviously takes in South Belfast. And there will be disparities there. But I do think that it is right that we take measures to, where we can, to ensure that there are jobs that can be spread out, if they can, in different parts of the country. But we have to understand as well that when investors come, especially we think of foreign direct investment, they come and they're looking for specific things. And we can't always just push them towards a corner if it doesn't have what is needed in that area for jobs to grow where it doesn't have the things that they're looking for. So I hope that members won't think that there's a conspiracy going on here. I hope that members don't use that word discrimination when it comes to the current distribution of jobs. But certainly from my own point of view, I would rather, obviously, that constituents of mine have jobs in their own constituency. But I'd rather have some of my constituents have to travel to Belfast for a job rather than not have a job at all. So I hope we've placed on record the importance of creating more and better jobs. I understand where the members in the SDLP are coming from in regards to their motions. We'll be happy on that basis to accept it today.
Sir, Colm Eastwood, Leishan Lasu Awalu. I call Colm Eastwood to move the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I thank party opposite for their support for our amendment. And of course, we can put lots of amendments down and lots of motions, and we can write lots of things and draft frameworks and all sorts of things. But what I suppose we want to see from now on is change and action. I'm not going to use the word discrimination. I don't think I have to, because we've had decades upon decades of a lack of investment in the west, west of the ban, and I think we now see the results of that. It is good that we should have more and better jobs. Of course it is. We need more and better jobs. But we also need to ensure, and I'm not talking here about directing investors and saying you have to set up in Derry, or you have to set up in Strabane, or you have to set up in Enniskillen. What we're saying is, let's ensure that those investors do have the things that they require in the areas that have been left behind. Let's ensure that the act of discrimination that was 50 years ago, more than 50 years ago now, of denying the city of Derry a proper functioning university to ensure that we could attract that type of investment. Let's ensure that those mistakes aren't compounded and compounded and compounded by us not actually doing something about it. So we're coming at this and we're glad, I think, we found some common ground. This is a good way for us to begin this new era of opposition. But what we want to see now is more than just motions. What we want to see is actual actions. And I have to be honest, we were treated yesterday evening to an analysis of the election results. And we know who won the election. We know how many seats we have, and we know how many seats Sinn Féin have, and the DUP have, and the Ulster Unionist Party have. We can all read. We were all there for the counts. But let me be very, very clear. It will be a fundamental mistake for people in this House to think that that election was an election that said, everything's fine over here, don't worry about us, you have our support. Well, let's look at the election. Sinn Féin didn't win the election in Foyle. Sinn Féin lost a seat in West Belfast, and they lost a seat in Fermanagh. I think the story, one of the stories, one of the many stories of this election, was an enormous amount of frustration and anger in places like my own city, in places like parts of Fermanagh, in places like West Belfast, where people are just saying we're fed up with government just existing. Government now needs to finally, for once and for all, tackle the inequalities that have been allowed to be fostered throughout the last number of decades. Because I am fed up looking at the faces of sad parents who have spent years educating and supporting their children and basically raising them for export. Because I don't know how many times I have to go at Christmas time to airports to pick people up and to leave them off because they can't find the quality of life and the quality of employment in my city that they would like to find. Would surely, yeah.
To the member for giving way, and whilst I don't accept all of the fundamentals of his critique that he has offered, I do accept some of them. Bearing that in mind, bearing how desperately bad he tells us the situation is, was it not a catastrophic mistake on his part when he had the opportunity to put his shoulder to the wheel and play his part in the Government of Northern Ireland in fixing the problems that he has identified? He shirked that opportunity.
No, I didn't shirk any opportunity. What we did throughout the whole election process was say to people that if we could, in the two-week process, and by the way, nobody from your party or any other party contradicted me when I said this, that we would spend 2 weeks negotiating a draft programme for government. Not a whole detailed programme for government, but a draft programme for government with some actions in it that we could sell to the people. And if we couldn't achieve the change that we needed to see in that programme for government, then of course we would go into opposition and hold the government to account in a constructive way. That's what we did. We're not shirking any responsibility. I think we're being very responsible. In fact, giving up the opportunity to be in government to try and hold government to account from outside. And we look forward to that developing. And I think this is the beginning of a harmonious relationship that we can develop over the next coming years. So, what do we need to do, Mr. Deputy Speaker, to change the lot of people in my constituency, to ensure that they're not being raised for export, to try and keep them here to contribute to the economy here? We need to invest in the fundamentals. It is great that there have been two great infrastructural projects going to East Antrim. We did notice, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that that had happened. But the areas that have been left behind, the areas west of the ban, the areas like my city, like Strabane, like all parts of the west that haven't had big infrastructural projects, now need to see tarmac on the road as early as possible. Not a few miles, but all the miles. But we also need to see, and we talk about corporation tax, and we're big supporters of the devolution of corporation tax. It's been our party policy for about 30 years. We support the harmonisation of taxpayers across this island. But if you look at the speed of the recovery across the border, why has that happened? It's happened because they're an open economy. It's happened because they've invested massively in higher and further education, as well as reducing corporation tax. What we have done, we've promised a reduction of corporation tax, whilst at the very same time we've cut our investment in student places. And yes, of course, Mr. Stalford pointed out that we have frozen tuition fees. In fact, they have gone up higher than inflation. That is what's happened. And we now have an opportunity to reverse that. But we have a bigger opportunity to invest in places. Because the first thing on an investor's scorecard of an area isn't tax, it's skills. And I know from my own city, we have starved the opportunity to drag investors to the city. Because why would you go if we don't have a university at about 10,000 doing the right type of courses? Why would you go if we're looking at 3,500 undergraduate places? We need to invest in our economy up front to allow cities like mine to get on with the business of creating an economy, of keeping our people here and attracting people to come and live and set up businesses. That's what we want to see. That's what we think is important. That's the benchmarks on which we will judge this economic strategy and this programme for government. And I can't, Mr. Deputy Speaker, end before making the point that on the 23rd of June, we are faced with a very, very real and difficult choice. And if people in this Assembly believe that we can, on the one hand, leave the European Union and, on the other hand, turn around our economy, they are living in cloud cuckoo land. Investors who want to come here want to come because of the access to the markets of 500 million people, not 1.8 million, not even 60 million, 500 million people. The connections with our partners in the south, the cross-border opportunities that we have, will be all lost if we vote for a Brexit. And I know the DUP are a bit sort of they're against us remaining in the EU, but they're not really that against because they're not making that much of a big deal of it. They let Sammy out of the traps every now and again to talk about how dangerous it'll be. But there's not a big front bench. There's not a big front bench campaign coming from the DUP because I think they know, because they go to America as well. They talk to investors. They talk to higher and further education institutions. They know the benefits of remaining within the European Union. We know it as well. And if we are serious about turning around our economy, Mr Deputy Speaker, in Derry, Strabane, Fermanagh or Belfast, the idea that we can cut corporation tax on one hand, cut student places on the other and leave the European Union if we had a third hand is bizarre and wrong, and it would be absolutely stupid and reckless, and I hope that we don't do that. And I need to ask the question as well, because we're now getting very close to the point of reducing corporation tax. And I'd ask the Economy Minister, if he can at this early stage, and I welcome him to his position, can address the issue of what scoping work has been done to work out how we're going to fund the reduction in corporation tax without affecting frontline services. And I hope the Minister is in a position to answer that question. I do welcome him to his position. I welcome the fact that we once and for all have all the important parts of the economy under one roof. I think that's a good, reform in terms of our institutions. It also rings very loud and clear to me and to everyone out there that this Assembly and this Executive has now recognised that we can't build an economy unless we invest in further and higher education. I hope this Minister and I hope this Executive recognise the failure of closing down courses, cutting university places,
while
at the same time trying to invest
to a close,
in
please.
The economy. Thank you very much.
Right. Iremasair Kakerlach and Kostiak Namiakta Connor.
I welcome the debates, although I find myself in a position as Chair of the Economy Committee and somewhat invidious. We've now been debating for about 2 days matters relating to the Committee's remit, and the Committee has not yet had an opportunity to debate them themselves. Nonetheless, I congratulate the members of the Committee who have been out of the traps very early in getting some of these economic debates secured in the Assembly, and no doubt when the Committee does go on to consider and deliberate on the matters that are being debated today and indeed yesterday as part of the manufacturing strategy debate and indeed the programme for government debate, that the debates that we've been having in the Chamber over the last few days will inform that. So I am sure that the Committee will want to ensure that those views expressed by members in the Chamber, not just from the members of the Economy Committee, but broadly speaking, and indeed all wide spectrum of stakeholders, are taken into account when we are working on a draft economic strategy to complement the draft programme for government. And no doubt, given the nature and the intention of the programme for government process, that presumes that there will be the widest possible input from stakeholders. Of course, it is logical to assume that the economic strategy will be a part of the programme for government strategy. I'm not quite sure yesterday why people thought it was necessary to have a manufacturing strategy outside of the programme for government strategy and economic strategy, but nonetheless, consistency perhaps isn't something that's in large measure in this institution. But members will expect, and the IAS committee chair, and I'm sure the committee's members will expect the minister to engage as wide as possible in terms of formulating a strategy, not least with the committee itself. I should also repeat what I said yesterday during the manufacturing strategy debate. We can't simply develop a strategy which ignores the realities of the global economy and the balances and links between our economy, the economy in the south, the economy in Britain and the economy in Europe. And I share the points made by the last speaker in relation to the referendum upcoming and that very close link that we have with the European Union and the economic ties that we have there. An updated economic strategy may also require a review of the current job promotion model that we use. And again, this is likely to be a priority issue for the committee. And such a strategy, of course, as other members have alluded to, has to take into consideration the potential reduction in corporation tax. The previous economic strategy, published in March 2012, stated that the strategy has been launched at a time of sustained uncertainty in the global economy, and we recognise the impact that this continues to have on businesses and individuals. Last Concordia, that context has not changed, unfortunately, that much, and we still live in a time of global economic uncertainty, and we can't ignore the impact of that on the North. So again, as in 2012, we need to use all the economic levers and drivers at our disposal, and we must invest in innovation, in R&D, in skills and diversification within our economy. So the Economic Committee will continue to take briefings from the arms length bodies, from the department, and we will be challenging, I'm sure, very strongly to make sure that the department, in its contribution to the programme for government and meeting the outcomes that are already outlined in the draft programme for government framework, will be met and will be developed in a way which can grow in a balanced and reasonable way a very prosperous economy bearing in mind the global economic circumstances we face into. Just speaking on behalf of my party, I mean, as I think the proposer of the motion outlined, I have no difficulty with the amendment proposed by the SDLP at all. In essence, all that is in the amendment is already contained within the Programme for Government framework, which I suppose to me then points up a question as to, I listened to the leader of the SDLP outline the reasons why after 2 weeks of intense negotiations they decided to abandon their opportunity to be in the executive and actually have an input into all of this and walk away from Programme for Government negotiations. And yet at their first opportunity to amend a motion in relation to one of the central planks, which will be the economic strategy, they have simply come forward with amendments which already exist within the existing Programme for Government. Outcome one, we prosper through a strong, competitive, regionally balanced economy. This outcome is about increasing the productivity and success of local business in a sustainable and responsible way, ensuring that growth is balanced on a regional basis, and that ensures that growth benefits people in all parts of our region. It's already in there. The indicators for better paid jobs are there. Again, the amendment, which I think is in contradiction of the position adopted yesterday, says that the economic strategy should sit alongside the new programme for government. Surprisingly, the manufacturing strategy shouldn't. I don't understand the logic in that. So, I mean, if that's the type of opposition, I suppose, constructive opposition that we're to expect, it certainly is opposition without substance. And simply to say then, we don't want to be part of the programme for government negotiations because there's no substance in them, but we bring forward amendments and debates, and that's our contribution to trying to create a better economy, to create societal change in terms of protecting the vulnerable outside just simply producing some meaningless amendments in the debate. That's our contribution to constructive opposition. As I say, maybe so, but opposition without any degree of substance.
I call Steve Aiken.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and may I pass on my regards as well, and thanks for your elevation to do as well. I'm sorry that Mr. Lyons has actually left the chamber, because I was actually going to praise him. One of the strange things that we see ourselves as very much as being a constructive opposition is to be able to praise areas where areas have done well. One of the most interesting things is the growth, particularly in the economy. The growth of companies in the rest of Northern Ireland over the last couple of years has actually been a particularly strong thing. And I think we should also put praise, also where praise due, for those innovative, adaptive and agile companies themselves who have done so much against the sort of the tide of some of the poor business decisions that have been going on in Northern Ireland to actually make a success of it. But there's one particular area I would like to focus on, and echoing the words of our fellow leaders of the opposition, and I just wanted to talk about the issues particularly around the idea of skilled jobs and the issues to do with that. And I'm not playing Northern Ireland down. This isn't a Northern Ireland put-down issue, but we need to face some of the realities on the state of our ability to produce highly skilled and highly paid jobs in Northern Ireland. The provision of a skilled workforce and support to a greater fund for the research and development were issues that we, as an opposition, were wanting to see within the strategy for manufacturing. And we did wish to see it as a separate strategy, because we wanted to see that being the driving force of the future of the Northern Ireland economy, not being frittered away within some form of sort of the civil service ease or losing what else is going on with the government process as well. But one of my major concerns is the considerable underinvestment in our higher and further education sectors. And as somebody who's been an ex-CEO of a major Irish university, it's an issue that I and our universities, our business sectors and our unions are very acutely aware of. Indeed, to quote the noted academic and commentator Deirdre Heenan of Ulster University, that almost uniquely in the developed world, Northern Ireland is divesting in higher education. And we do have a brain drain. I know Mr. Stalford was very clear to say that we seem to have stopped the brain drain, but we haven't, and the figures show that is the case. Indeed, with the level of funding for students in Northern Ireland being less than £1,000 everywhere else in the United Kingdom, it should be noticed that we should be looking at that as a matter of disquiet, or even a potential disgrace, that our government has stood over a steady reduction in the potential of upskilling our workforce, while our competitors in Manchester, which sits at the 56th university standings, Edinburgh 24th, Glasgow 76th, and even Dublin with 160, have taken the opportunity to invest in these wealth-creating centres. Indeed, looking at the recent record, you presume that our universities be seen as a burden rather than an asset. It is also noteworthy that our universities are dropping down, not rising up global rankings. We no longer have a top global 100 university in Northern Ireland. We barely scrape into the top 200. And this is a significant problem, not just for our reputation, but also for our competitiveness and attractiveness as a centre for FDI and innovation. But I'm not just doing Northern Ireland, the university sector, down. It is noteworthy that when collaboration between our universities and industry works, it works well. There's just not enough of it. And there appears to be a marked reluctance to boost this cooperative and mutually beneficial approach. And the state of the modern apprenticeships is also a concern that should be raised higher up our national risk register. That is, as if we even do have a national risk register, which I think we should have. From shortages in skilled workers in the building sector, so that even if we did need to build a lot of social housing, we don't have the workers to do it. They're already being employed and working on HS2 and major works within the Northern Powerhouse. The skilled technicians working in the farmer and the agribusiness sectors are all impediments to achieving an effective economic strategy. We also need to make the message that apprenticeship route is not some form of second-class educational approach. Apprenticeships should be valued as much as the degree route, and we as an Assembly should be promoting that view and investing in further education colleges. We're also conscious of the cost of potential additional expenditure and costs, but we need to ask the question, can we afford not to do this? Can we afford not to invest in our higher education sector as well? I would also like, while we've got a few minutes, just to talk on the issues of regional investment or lack thereof. I will not revisit the opportunity lost by not rebuilding the new campus of Ulster University in Londonderry, where it should have been. But as a transformational point, higher education can make a significant change in the rest of it. But finally, and just for the few seconds I have left, I would like to point out that this is all moot. If we do not, and we do not move towards a vote to remain within the EU, come the end of this month, we would be in a position where all this would be moot, and actually all our sort of plans for future economic development would no longer be successful. Thank you.
I call Trevor Lunn.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and congratulations on your appointment. We will support both the motion and the amendment. On the motion, it has already been stated by the Executive on several occasions that there would be a new economic strategy developed in conjunction with the Programme for Government, a new budget, a social strategy and an investment strategy. So the amendment does provide some additional emphasis upon the critical aspect of skills. I will, however, shortly make a few qualifications around the issue of regional balance. Alliance shares the aim and ambition to make Northern Ireland the most innovative and dynamic regional economy in Europe. But to do this, we can no longer rely on what made us prosperous in the past. We must invest in the skills infrastructure and harness the creativity needed to ensure our economy is fit for the 21st century. Improving our level of productivity is an essential part of any new economic approach. Alliance believes that despite the challenges facing the economy, Northern Ireland has the resources to emerge from this period of austerity stronger and more competitive. We have an enterprising and resilient business base, a youthful and well-educated population, a strong manufacturing base, excellent research and innovation attributes, a world-class telecommunications network, strong international links, and unique natural and cultural resources. So, Mr. Deputy Speaker, our strengths obviously outweigh our weaknesses. But despite some of the good developments on the economic front over the past 5 years, there have been missed opportunities, and Northern Ireland has not been transformed in line with its full potential. As others have said, Mr. Deputy Speaker, any discussion on our future economic prospects has to reflect the current uncertainty posed by the EU referendum and the implications that would flow from any vote to leave. The single market provides us with massive trading opportunities and the scope to grow our exports. Access to markets is the biggest danger, the biggest issue for investors looking at Northern Ireland. If we left, there would be a real danger that investments would go elsewhere. The vast majority of economic experts strongly recommend a Remain vote, as we do, as all the parties do here except for the DUP. I can't help thinking, I reflected on what Mr. Eastwood said, that I think he's right that the DUP secretly know that the population in Northern Ireland is going to make a decision for them, so they can take their stand, but they know what the result will be. We do support the development of a robust interdepartmental economic strategy. which should focus on job protection and creation in the short term, as well as set out a clear long-term strategy for increasing productivity and competitiveness that builds on our key strengths. A central element of this strategy must be a plan to invest in the key economic drivers such as skills and infrastructure. This imperative is particularly acute in the context of a lower rate of corporation tax. This cannot and will not, however, be a silver bullet in isolation. The lessons from elsewhere are clear. This will only work in the context of supporting investments. Indeed, there needs to be a lead-in time. Now, we have increasingly become concerned at the absence of a proper plan around this lower rate of corporation tax. Because, Mr Deputy Speaker, the clock is ticking. And I do wonder, Mr Murphy spent half of his speech berating the opposition, but I would like to know if Sinn Féin are totally committed to the principle of reduction in corporation tax. Also, following on from yesterday's debate, we should also ensure that there is a strong manufacturing focus and a refreshed economic strategy. One of the critical areas of intervention needs to be in relation to skills. Over the past 5 years, we have seen the development of a wider range of policies and programmes to develop skills, including higher-level skills, to make those skills more relevant to the economy and to bring people closer to the labour market. But this work has been limited by lack of resources and, more recently, budget cuts. So investment needs to be scaled up, and we estimate, it's been said before, that we need to see a step up by which an additional £85 million each year is spent on skills by 2019-20. In particular, this would allow us to address the current funding gap in higher education, continue to freeze tuition fee levels for local students, and to expand our provision of high-level skills. I think it's also important to make some qualification on the point around regional disparities. We do have a responsibility to ensure that everyone in Northern Ireland has economic opportunities and ensure an economic and social vibrancy in all parts of the province, including Londonderry. But we need to be careful to balance the overall size of the
Northern Ireland
economy.
I would ask the member to bring his remarks to a close.
Yes, indeed, and the internal distribution of that economy. If we overmanage the latter, we risk compromising the former. I'll leave it at that, Mr. Speaker. Thank you very much.
I call Tom Buchanan.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And it is the desire of every government to increase and strengthen their economy, which is the backbone of every society. And due to the many factors which drive it forward, it is therefore essential that improving the economy is at the very heart of the programme for government. If Northern Ireland is to be successful on a global scale and punch well above its weight on the world stage, it is imperative that we as a government focus on the creation of more and better jobs and better job opportunities within Northern Ireland. It is no longer an option to stand back and to watch our educated young people leave our shores with the age-old complaint that there is no jobs back home for them. When we ask our young people where they want to work, their answer is normally always the same. They love Northern Ireland, they want to remain within our shores, but they're simply not the job opportunities or the right type of jobs to keep them here. Now, I know and I acknowledge and I want to acknowledge the tremendous work that the executive did over the last 5 years, and we did hear the proposer of the motion quote the figures of the jobs that were created, the new employment opportunities, but more needs to be done, and therefore we cannot take our eye off the ball. The foundation, I believe, has been laid and well laid, and we must continue to build upon that foundation. The children and young people in our schools, colleges and universities today are the workforce of tomorrow. And it is the responsibility of everyone in this House, along with the executive, to take the tough choices today to ensure that their future is secure here in Northern Ireland and that they have the opportunities to forge successful careers and their chosen fields of work here at home. A successful economy does not come in isolation, though, but is built on partnership between the government, industry and education. Working in partnership will not only deliver, I believe, a highly skilled workforce capable of meeting the real business needs, but will underpin economic growth by the opening of the new opportunities that is required. However, it is no secret that in many places and in many areas of employment, employers bemoan the skills gap which exists amongst our young people. And we're all well aware of that. In the last Assembly term in the Dáil Committee, and I mentioned this yesterday and I come back to it again today, we did look right throughout that term at the skills gap that existed and worked on those issues. This is not to say, though, that our young people have no skills, but rather that they don't have the right skills to meet the job opportunities which arise. And I think that's the issue we need to address. We don't want to come to this chamber today and put our young people down, because that's not what we're doing. Our young people are skilled and well-skilled, but they're not skilled in the right way and the right to meet the opportunities which arise within the job sector. And that is something I think that we need to look at, and look at with our universities and with our employers to ensure that our young people are skilled in the field that meets the job opportunities that will arise whenever they come here to Northern Ireland. And another issue that we need to be looking at is the improving of our infrastructure. And again, our infrastructure is a big issue, and I think on my own constituency of West Tyrone, where the roads infrastructure, and there needs to be improvement there. And I do know that again, in the last Assembly term, there has been efforts to seek to bring forward the improvement of the A5. And it's still sitting there. It hasn't been able to come, not as a fault of this executive, but because of other issues. So therefore, we need to be looking at the whole issue of the infrastructure in our roads, and also, as was mentioned, in broadband. And again, this is a huge issue that we have in West Tyrone. While we come to Oma, and we have excellent broadband cover and facilities within Oma, when we move out into the rural areas where we do have the businesses, small businesses and the farming, if you like, industry that needs that broadband cover, it's not there. So again, that is something I would ask the Minister that he would look at.
Thank the Member for giving way. And we've talked a lot about infrastructure, both in terms of roads and broadband, and that's important. Would the Member also agree with me that another part of our infrastructure is actually in terms of aviation and the links that we have, for example, with London, and the importance of good transport links and being able to move people and freight? And doesn't he agree that the lack of a decision in terms of aviation capacity in the South East doesn't only hurt the rest of the UK, but hurts Northern Ireland as well, which is dependent upon those air links?
The Member's next minute.
Absolutely, couldn't agree more with my colleague. Again, the transport network and infrastructure was another issue that I had on my notes here. But again, that is something that needs to be looked at, and would ask the Minister again to take that on board, to take all these issues on board as we seek to move forward, because there is a lot of work that needs to be done in this term of government. We need to be radical in our thinking and open up long-term thinking within this House.
The Member draws remarks to a close, please.
And it is our opportunity to work together to bring forward good for Northern Ireland, and to be able to sell Northern Ireland on the world stage to say, here's what we have, here's what we have on offer, come you and be one of us.
Call Alex Maskey.
It's okay.
I call Emma Little Pengilly.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to welcome the motion and to add my voice for the very strong case for the updating and bringing forward a revised economic strategy. In many ways, my wonderful constituency of Belfast South is a manifestation of what we want to achieve. We have the highest level of third level educated residents. We've got relatively high wages, relatively low unemployment, fantastic businesses including startups, fabulous universities and schools. We have got excellent commercial and retail centres such as the Lisburn Road, Drummillis Road, Ormo Road and Finnegy, and many others. Just a few months ago, I was hugely humbled to be asked by the South Belfast Partnership Board to be the South Belfast Economic Champion. And what is clear through this work and my actions on the ground is that despite those headline figures, challenges remain. South Belfast, like so much of Northern Ireland, can be a game of two halves. We have much educational excellence, but we also have levels of low educational attainment and underachievement. We have excellent retail areas, but with challenges in relation to rates, parking and tough trading environments. We've got great schools and universities, but with the need for resources and support if those schools and universities will fully play the role they want to play in growing our economy. To achieve our objective of growing the economy will require two things coming together. Yes, absolutely, good and high-value jobs, but also a workforce with the necessary skills and tools to be able to access those jobs, to be able to create those jobs, but also to grow within those jobs and expand. I've just come from the all-party group on tackling educational underachievement and promoting educational excellence for all. This is a critical part in building our economy. In that group and right across all parties, there's a very wide consensus in what we want to achieve. We want every child to succeed. But we need to have a hard conversation about what is success in that context. And to me, success is a person, a young person, with the necessary tools and skills to be able to get a reasonable job with a reasonable wage. So creating the jobs will be part of the economic strategy, but we need to give these young people the necessary tools and skills to be able to access that. Growing our economy will require a wide range of initiatives and actions, a highly skilled workforce, increasing educational achievement, the supply of good quality jobs, attracting investment, but also support for our local Indigenous businesses to allow those to grow, providing the conditions for business startup, and critically encouraging those entrepreneurs who will take the risk and create those jobs we want to see and we need to see. It is only through all of those initiatives working together will we build the vibrant, innovative, entrepreneurial and dynamic Northern Ireland that we all want to see. Thank you.
Alan Chambers, and as this is Mr. Chambers' first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would remind the House that it is a convention, as it is his maiden speech, that it be made without interruption. Mr. Chambers.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, it is a privilege and an honour to have this opportunity today to make my first contribution to the proceedings of this House. I hope that it will be the first of many opportunities. I'm extremely grateful to the people of North Down who voted for me to represent them in this Assembly. I pledge to represent all the citizens of North Down with the vigour and commitment they would expect from me. I was born and reared just a short distance from this iconic building in the shadows of the gantries of the Harlanwood shipyard. Indeed, my father worked there for some time, along with thousands of others, building some of the finest ships in the world. I am proud of my East Belfast early year roots. However, in 1973, I moved to Bangor, and having lived there since then, my family and myself are very proud to call North Down our home. I've been local government representative in North Down for nearly 25 years. I'm very proud of some of the achievements that we achieved in local government over that period, and I know that there are others currently serving in this chamber who would share that pride in things like the, I'm thinking of the Aurora Leisure Centre, the restoration of the Walled Garden in Bangor, the public realm work that's been carried out, upgrading play parks, community halls, and indeed our new community hub due to open soon on Hamilton Road in Bangor, and indeed leisure facilities in Hollywood. North Down has the reputation of being the Gold Coast, but it also has areas of deprivation. And one of my challenges will be to try and make North Down a Gold Coast for every one of its residents. The redevelopment of Queen's Parade will need all the support and encouragement that this Assembly can offer. Hopefully our new Education Minister will be able to find the money to finally enable urgent rebuilds of a number of school campuses that are not entirely fit for purpose. And I know that Minister Weir has been
heavily involved over the years in lobbying with the rest of us to try and make the dream come true for Prairie College in Hollywood, St Columbanus College in Bangor, and Central Primary School in Bangor. And perhaps Invest Northern Ireland will look beyond the Gold Coast reputation and send some much-needed manufacturing jobs in our direction. It would be remiss of me not to mention the contribution to North Down and to this House made by our former MLA, Mr. Leslie Cree, MBE. Now retired from public life, I wish Leslie and his family every happiness for the future. Knowing Leslie, I will not be surprised if he finds some voluntary public service work to keep himself busy. In Bangor, we are very fortunate to have a first-class further education facility, Southeastern Regional College, SERC, managed and staffed by a highly motivated group of tutors. This college has risen to the challenge in the past of tailoring courses to suit upcoming opportunities like those presented when the Aurora Leisure Complex was open. Going forward, we cannot afford to starve places of further education like SERC of funding if we expect them to step up and provide the training required to fill future skill set requirements. Lack of funding in this area will be an impediment to growth of our economy. We must be prepared in this House to speculate, to accumulate for our people. Workplace apprenticeships are also vital to prepare our workforce for future opportunities. Everything must be done to give employers incentives to provide apprenticeships and facilitate apprenticeships. We must also look hard at our infrastructure. Our road and rail network requires detailed planning and financial resources. Our broadband network, we've talked about, many black spots in Bangor. There are some huge challenges to be confronted within an economic strategy, and my party have no hesitation in supporting the motion as amended. I'm disappointed that an opposition motion to create a manufacturing strategy was rejected by this House yesterday, as I think it would have complemented this motion. Over recent days, I've heard much comment from executive spokespeople about the complaining and indeed the whinging coming from those in opposition. Today, the word disrespect was even mentioned.
Would I ask the member to draw his remark to a close, please?
I get the feeling there's such an obsession with opposition that we're actually seeing the birth of an opposition to the opposition. We need to be aware that every healthy democracy has an opposition to scrutinise and critique the performance of government. My party will not be found wanting in pursuit of our opposition duties. However, in conclusion, what we will not be doing is apologising for carrying out our duties as part of an official opposition.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
Thank you. Members, the Business Committee has agreed to meet at 1 p.m. today, so therefore I propose by leave of the Assembly to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. We'll return to the debate on the economic strategy when the next speaker will be Mr. Daniel McCrossan. The sitting is by leave then suspended. Thank you.
Okay, members, we'll return to the debate on the economic strategy. And our next speaker is Mr. Daniel McCrossan.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and may I take this opportunity to congratulate you on your recent elevation on your new role. Today I'll be rising to support the amendment for this very important debate, not only as the MLA for West Tyrone, but also as the SDLP spokesperson for infrastructure. Madam Speaker, in the north of this island, the east-west divide remains as stark as ever. Nearly 20 years after the Good Friday Agreement and peace, there has been a failure to address the serious skills and infrastructural deficits which have squandered long-term strategies and crucial business regeneration west of the Bann. Information obtained by the detail last year shows this stark underinvestment in deprived communities across Northern Ireland, but particularly in the west and in rural areas. This is something we have known for some time, but the figures are absolutely overwhelming. In the last 3.5 years, over 80% of funding offered by InvestNI for Indigenous businesses have been made to those in the East. This comes despite the well-documented, historic underinvestment in communities west of the Bann, where villages and towns teeter on the brink of instability. West Tyrone, Madam Speaker, has received only 2.1% of the overall financial assistance available by InvestNI, so it is no surprise that this inequality is haunting my local community and has done for decades. Regional inequality is evident if we look at Ards and North Down, for example, who have the highest rate of employment and the highest rate of economic activity at 73.8% and 76.2% respectively. This is in stark contrast to my own area in Strabane, which held the lowest level of employment at 56.6% and the lowest level of economic activity at 66.5%. It comes as no surprise that my town of Strabane and the constituency of West Tyrone consistently tops the UK deprivation charts year on year, which is having dramatic repercussions for our people. Strabane has fallen foul to chronic unemployment and underinvestment for decades. I see this each and every day across my constituency, Madam Speaker. There is multi-generational neglect, with people stuck in a cycle of poverty, left with little hope and no aspiration. Our young people are leaving in their droves to find greater economic opportunities elsewhere, simply and sadly because they see no future here, certainly not west of the ban. This may be a difficult pill for this House to swallow, Madam Speaker, but one we must collectively deal with, and fast. But those are the ones that got away. Each week I hear about the awfulness faced by some of our young people across my constituency, their depression, anxiety and frustration, sometimes leading to high levels of addiction, alcohol and drug abuse, and sometimes, given the reality, suicide. This awfulness could have been avoided had there been meaningful work, if they were given some hope and some aspiration for a better future here at home, close to their families and within their own communities. This underscores, Madam Speaker, the failure of successive ministers to spread the wealth-generating potential of the North across all those who are living here. Madam Speaker, in this mandate, regional imbalance is supposed to be a key priority for the new Programme for Government framework. But if the last Programme for Government is anything to go by, with almost half of the targets not delivered, I do not have much confidence that the new one will deliver positive change. The new framework does not have any specific targets, measurables or increments on how it is going to change the economic fortunes of the people across my constituency and the others that have suffered from decades of neglect. We were even told last year that ministers were taking responsibility for the generational neglect of the North West and the West. The Ministerial Subgroup on Economic Inactivity for the North West has met twice since then, only twice, the second time with 24 hours' notice. Madam Speaker, it is not just job opportunities that are lacking in West Tyrone. One of the big disappointments in many rural areas is that it still lacks a proper roads infrastructure, which directly contributes to regional imbalance. Motorways such as A5 and A6 will allow all businesses from all over the North greater access to markets, boost travel efficiencies and allow skill-based greater movement. For all that was promised, what we are left with is a £100 million allocation from the Stormont House Agreement and a flurry of activity on a very small section of road. Only £13.1 million was given to the A5 this year, and after two consultation processes already, I hope that it is not another empty promise of proper investment, and I sincerely hope that this money does not end up in another monitoring round. Madam Speaker, a necessary skills base remains absolutely vital to the development of a competitive and healthy economy while allowing people to personally prosper. New skills open new opportunities and grant people the tools they need to succeed. Businesses rely on skilled workforces to allow them to not only make
a
profit, but to expand, grow within a new region. Madam Speaker, I'll finish on this. There needs to be a targeted approach from this Assembly on the areas of most need, economically, in terms of infrastructure and jobs.
Members' time is
up. And the leadership needs to come here. Thank you.
I now call the Minister for the Economy, Mr Simon Hamilton, and he will have 15 minutes.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I welcome this debate and the opportunity to respond to both the motion and the amendment. The motion calls for the Executive to focus on creating more and better jobs in Northern Ireland and to bring forward an updated economic strategy alongside the new Programme for Government. An ambition to create more and better jobs for all of our people is one that I am sure that everyone in this Assembly would support. Refocusing the current economic strategy will afford the opportunity to ensure that it is aligned with the outcomes set in the new Programme for Government framework and takes account of changes within our economy. I'd like to assure members that my department has already commenced this work. Members may be aware that the Executive's economic strategy was published back in March of 2012 with a long-term vision to up until 2030 of, quote, an economy characterised by a sustainable and growing private sector where a greater number of firms compete in global markets and there is growing employment and prosperity for all. Principal Deputy Speaker, the economic strategy was designed as a living document to be reviewed and adjusted on an ongoing basis to ensure that as a region we can respond to and exploit national and international market opportunities and meet the challenges created within a global economy. That said, I believe that the long-term vision articulated in 2012 remains very much valid today. The aim of the economic strategy is to improve the economic competitiveness of the economy through a focus on export-led economic growth. The strategy further recognises that regional disparities exist and that we need to ensure balanced growth across Northern Ireland. It also recognises the importance of cities as drivers of economic growth, with Belfast and Londonderry are both key population and economic centres and as such will be a catalyst for growth across Northern Ireland. Creating jobs alone can only be part of any solution to achieving balanced regional growth. As Mr Murphy pointed out, it is something that is key and central and contained within the draft programme for government framework.
I welcome the 2012-2030 document as it was. One of the key underpinnings of that document that was briefed, particularly in the business community at the time, was the continued membership of the United Kingdom within the European Union. Would the Minister care to comment whether potential changes of Northern Ireland and the UK living in the European Union would have a significant impact on any future economic strategy?
I'm not sure. The member perhaps recalls it better than I did. If he does, he gets a mark for that. I'm not sure if it did have that as an underpinning of the economy in Northern Ireland. Although, of course, it was a fact and it continues to be a fact, and we will see after the 23rd of June whether that remains the case or not. Look, I understand the points, Principal Deputy Speaker, that are made by many within the business community, the concerns they have about potential of leaving the European Union, because business wants certainty, and there would of course be a degree of uncertainty if Northern Ireland, as part of the United Kingdom, were to leave the European Union. But equally, I listen to many of the same businesses, many of the same business organisations who are looking for, indeed some of the members of this House have yesterday, again today, and will continue, I'm sure, at question time and other economic debates that we will have in this place, to ask for this executive to make a range of interventions, many of which are our ability to do so are hampered by the fact that we are members of the European Union and state aid rules in particular. So things around energy, like rates, the member mentioned rates yesterday. So our ability to, if we wanted to offer or afford further relief in respect of industrial derating, that is prohibited by state aid rules. So there are a range of areas in which, and many, some sectors, fishing industry, for example, which is something which is has a base within my constituency, who would believe that their business, their markets, their opportunities have been thwarted as being part of the European Union. And I don't accept either that an economy the size of the United Kingdom, the fourth or the fifth largest in the world by whatever barometer that you wish to use, would not be able to survive outside of the European Union. And yes, there would be change, and I understand the concerns that some would have about that, but I think it is a lack of ambition to believe that an economy the size of the United Kingdom, of which Northern Ireland is an integral part, couldn't do well and thrive and survive outside of the European Union. I was going to go on and congratulate the member on his inventiveness for introducing that at this point. I was going to address some of the points that Mr McCrossan and his party leader raised in terms of regional imbalance and a lack of growth. And I understand the points that Mr McCrossan and indeed Mr Eastwood made, and sometimes there can be a perception or a feeling, or in their argument a reality, that there is an imbalance in growth. I was talking yesterday to one of our largest inward investors in recent years, the company called Allstate, who of course have a presence, not just in Belfast, but also in Londonderry and also in the member's hometown of Strabane. And I'm sure the member, like all members in this House, would like to see more companies like that investing in their own constituency, but I think the member should acknowledge, and I'm sure he does acknowledge, that that is a very welcome investment into Strabane, and we would like to see that investment by Allstate and companies like them increase, not just in Strabane, but in all parts of Northern Ireland. To address specifically the point of our regional imbalance, and I think we have to accept and acknowledge that the bulk of our population in Northern Ireland resides in the east of Northern Ireland and around particularly Greater Belfast. If you look at figures for the 2011 to 2012 to 15-16 period, and you look at Invest Northern Ireland support, in the east of Northern Ireland, 282 jobs were supported per 10,000 of the population.
And if you look in the west of Northern Ireland, it was 301 jobs per 10,000 of the population. So if you take it on a per capita basis, and not just on a pure where are the pounds actually going to, but where are they going in respect of where people are, it is a higher figure in the west of Northern Ireland. If you look at 15-16 specifically, in the east it was 28 jobs per 10,000, and in the west it was 55 jobs per 1,000. And over the last 5 years as a whole, in terms of in the 42,500 jobs that were supported by Invest Northern Ireland over those five-year period, 64% of those jobs are outside of Belfast. So this perception that all of the jobs, or the majority of the jobs, are going to Belfast doesn't bear scrutiny whenever you look at the facts. But I do accept that creating jobs alone can only be one part of any solution to achieving balanced regional growth, and it will therefore be important to continue with investment in the key drivers of economic growth, that being innovation, research and development, and skills. We know from research that businesses which are innovative and invest more in R&D are more likely to be successful in global markets, employ more people and pay higher salaries. In other words, more and better jobs. Before dealing specifically with the refocus of the economic strategy, it might be helpful if I were to briefly outline some of the progress which has been made on it to date. At the time of the development of the economic strategy in 2011, the local economy was faced with many challenges. In line with many other regions and nations, the economy had been adversely impacted by the global economic recession, which had partially reversed some of the positive trends which we had been experiencing up to that time. Since the publication of the strategy back in March of 2012, our economic recovery is now well established on a number of fronts. This is most evident by improvements in our labour market statistics. In April of this year, there was a further fall of 600 people claiming unemployment benefits, bringing the total of almost 24,000 fewer since the strategy was launched. Within the local economy, we have seen over 38,000 additional jobs, and our employment rate has increased to 69%, up almost 2 percentage points over that period. Economic inactivity also stands at its lowest point since it has been measured, although there is still some distance for us to go to bring it in line with the UK average. In the modern workplace, qualifications and ongoing training are becoming more and more important in enhancing people's ability to access better employment opportunities. We've been providing opportunities for people to move up the skills ladder, with almost 300,000 qualifications achieved through higher education, further education and ongoing training over the last programme for government period. In 2013, Northern Ireland's private sector output growth was above the UK average. While this slipped in 2014, it still remains above the level of private sector growth here when the economic strategy was launched. The most recent data reflects a more positive position across all of our main sectors. Both the services and manufacturing sectors have shown growth in output and jobs, whilst the construction sector, our most impacted sector during the downturn, has posted impressive growth since 2012, albeit still remaining below its previous peak reached in 2007. The vision which was set out in the economic strategy in 2012 was long-term and reflected the reality that a major rebalancing of the local economy with a larger, stronger private sector would take some time. Positive progress has been made and is reflected across a range of indicators. However, I am clear, as is the executive as a whole, that there remains much more to be done if we are to develop a strong, vibrant, sustainable economy which can provide opportunity and prosperity for all. If I can turn to the refocus of the Northern Ireland Economic Strategy, I've stated that the strategy was designed as a living document, and when it was drawn up, it was done so in anticipation of a positive decision to reduce the rate of corporation tax. Having secured those powers to lower the rate of corporation tax to 12.5% from April 2018, this provides a major policy stimulus for making a significant impact to the Northern Ireland economy. I view corporation tax as a key economic lever that can help us achieve long-term economic goals and ultimately help to secure greater economic growth and more and better jobs for our people. The refocus of the economic strategy will afford an opportunity to ensure that existing policies and strategies are revised and that any necessary new ones developed to ensure that we can maximise the potential economic benefits of a lower rate of corporation tax. The addition of reduced corporation tax to our existing investment proposition of talent and value added has the potential to make Northern Ireland the most attractive location in Western Europe for new foreign direct investment. Ulster University's Economic Policy Centre has reported that the reduction in the corporation tax rate could lead to an increase in investments from businesses involved in areas such as manufacturing or large-scale research and development, creating in excess of 30,000 new jobs by 2033. InvestNI will continue to focus on attracting high-value FDI jobs, and the agency is currently working with my department on detailed research aimed at informing and developing specific targeted propositions for those sectors to which Northern Ireland continues to offer excellent investment opportunities. In the strategy, we acknowledge that corporation tax is an important lever to transform our economy, but will not in itself be sufficient to make the total transformation that we need. We must continue with efforts to improve other areas in the economy, which will ensure we can maximise the potential gains from corporation tax, creating the conditions for local private sector growth and economic competitiveness. To achieve this, we must work to strengthen our performance in each of the five key rebalancing themes set out in the economic strategy, and will specifically seek to strengthen innovation and R&D capabilities to support investments, ensure the supply of skills meets the demands of our economy, deliver business growth across the region, compete globally for high-value investors through targeted promotion and support, and ensure the appropriate economic infrastructure is in place to meet the needs of new investors. The economic strategy represents an integrated approach to developing and growing our economy. The refocus strategy will continue to encourage and be based on collaboration. To be successful, we have to ensure that we have an effective partnership involving the public, private, and voluntary and community sectors. The motion calls on the executive to focus on creating more and better jobs in Northern Ireland. To do so, it will be important that the refocused economic strategy aligns with the new outcomes-based programme for government. This new approach for the next programme for government is currently out for consultation. This fresh start commitment is a marked change from previous programmes for government. It will require greater collaboration and working together, not just within and across our departmental boundaries, but also between sectors, public, voluntary and private. This is a real challenge, Principal Deputy Speaker, but also potentially a great opportunity. New thinking and new working methods will be required to deliver progress, working together, not just in the executive, but with all partners, local government, our arm's length bodies, and importantly, the private sector. This approach to the PFG is completely aligned with the refocus of the economic strategy. No one department will be able to deliver progress on its own, so collaboration will be essential, and this will transform the way that we work. The outcome to which this motion specifically refers to is to have more people working in better jobs. I see this as increasing the number of people working in jobs which are sustainable, well paid, and which offer opportunity for development and advancement. It is also about ensuring that employment opportunities exist at all levels for our people and encouraging our talented people to remain here for employment and to progress up the skills ladder. We must also attract the best talent to Northern Ireland, including attracting back those who have moved abroad by creating high-value job opportunities. Principal Deputy Speaker, in supporting this motion, I want to ensure that there is clear alignment between a refocused economic strategy and the outcomes set out in the programme for government. Having more people working in better jobs will be about attracting high-quality employers and encouraging growth of Indigenous businesses to offer good, sustainable employment opportunities. We will need to ensure that our workforce has the right high-quality skills to meet the demands of employers now and into the future. This will mean that we must work to improve the skills profile of our workforce and the prospects of the future workforce by improving educational outcomes. Principal Deputy Speaker, the refocus of the economic strategy will give us the opportunity to explore those issues identified by the next programme for government in more detail and outline how delivery of these issues can contribute to growing the Northern Ireland economy and ultimately deliver more and better jobs for our people. Thank you.
Éirim Sinéad Bradley. I call Sinéad Bradley to wind.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and congratulations on your elevation and also the Minister here today. I look forward to working with you both. A common thread that across the debate today has been the need for the development of infrastructure, both in terms of roads and digital infrastructure, alongside the development of skills. Many also expressed concern that an exit from Europe would have serious detrimental consequences for the Northern Ireland economy. Gordon Lyons, on speaking to the amendment, expressed that he had no particular objection to it, but also indicated he recognised the need for distribution of jobs on a regional basis. Despite this, he stated his thoughts that foreign direct investors may wish to locate in more developed areas where the requirements are not compromised in any way. Colm Eastwood referred to decades of lack of investment in west of the ban and the need to address and tackle the inequalities that exist. Only when this is done, he believed, that foreign direct investors will be drawn to such areas that are in need of these high-value jobs and the export of our young people can finally stop. Mr Eastwood highlighted, and I quote, the lack of tarmac and needs for large infrastructure
commitment west of the ban. He described as stupid and reckless any promotion to leave Europe campaign with regard to our Northern Ireland economy. Mr Eastwood closed by asking the Minister if he could advise what scoping work had been done to fund the reduction in corporation tax. Conor Murphy shared the concerns raised by Colm Eastwood in relation to Europe. He mirrored the view of his government colleague Gordon Lyons when he indicated that he had no objection to the amendment in principle. Mr Murphy, however, did not recognise that there being an added value in being specific about high-value or high-skilled and highly paid jobs, as they were, in his own interpretation of the draft government, sufficiently indicated. Mr Murphy also expressed some confusion that the economic strategy should sit alongside the new programme for government, given that there were calls for a specific manufacturing strategy yesterday. He did, however, also indicate that there had been issues had been brought to the floor without the opportunity for discussion at committee. Perhaps the sequence of events rolling forward will help give some clarity to such members, and he will then be not so unaware of the arguments that were made in support of the manufacturing strategy being specific. Peter Aiken addressed the House, and in opening he answered Mr Murphy and explained again the need for that manufacturing strategy, but he moved on to the business in front of us and expressed a concern of the underinvestment with the higher and further education sector and how that lack of investment is reflecting now in poor world rankings. He called also for a national risk register. Trevor Lunn indicated that he was supportive of the motion and the amendment, highlighted the need for updated skills and again an investment in infrastructure. He warned of the need for a supportive plan to be put in place around the reduction of corporation tax. Tom Buchanan made reference to the skills gap and described a mismatch that exists between developed skills that are not always right for the jobs that are there. He also referred to the need for broadband and infrastructure. Emma Little-Pengelly cited many of the challenges to growth, such as rates and car parking, etc., highlighted that people require the tools and the skills to become economically active. Alan Chambers delivered a very measured and considered maiden speech, congratulations on that, Alan, and referred to the need for more investment in the Golden Coast of North Down and the need for funding in CERC and places of education. We then moved on to Daniel McCrossan, who referred to the regional imbalance that exists, particularly Strabane and West Tyrone, and he basically referred to it as multi-generational neglect. And unfortunately, he expressed his view that he has a lack of confidence in the framework document that we are now relying on to develop our economy in Northern Ireland. The Minister addressed many of the issues raised and did directly look at the issue of regional imbalance. He did try to make a distinction, I suppose, between perception and what might actually be considered reality. And the need...
Can the member bring her remarks to a close?
Yes, surely. He did recognise the need for growth in the industry. I would like to just close by saying it may be an opportune moment to suggest the need for a ministerial subgroup to address further the problems that exist. Thank you.
I call on Mr Gordon Dunn to wind, and he will have 10 minutes.
I too welcome the opportunity and call on the Executive to focus on creating both more and better jobs, and to bring forward an updated economic strategy alongside the programme for government today. As I said yesterday, I was delighted that the number one outcome in the draft programme for government is that we prosper through a strong, competitive, regionally balanced economy. This puts the economy at the top, as the top priority for our executive. Creating more and better jobs is crucial as we seek to move this country forward and build a better Northern Ireland. Just as Northern Ireland is proudly taken to the field in France in the coming days, we take inspiration from our football team and how we can both take on and compete with the world's best. May I take this opportunity to wish the Northern Ireland team well as they put this country on the world stage and are real inspiration and true ambassadors for this proud country. And I'm sure you would fully endorse that principle, Deputy
I would appreciate
Speaker.
If the member would stick to the subject in question.
Well, that's very much the subject. As part of tourism, which I move on to, tourism continues to grow, and I believe we can see even greater growth here. Tourism is an exciting avenue which we must continue to embrace and develop. The success of world-famous events being hosted locally, events such as the Irish Open Golf, Circuit of Ireland Rally, the Northwest 200 and the Giro events, highlight how we can attract spectators and competitors to our shores and put on first-class events, showcasing the very best of what we have to offer, as well as creating jobs and stimulation within our economy and tourist sector. One only has to visit the Titanic Quarter on a Saturday afternoon, and you will soon realise the success of our story with the numbers of tourists and holidaymakers. And this can be further linked in with spreading visitors to neighbouring areas like North Down, like the Ulster Folk and Transport Museum at Kiltraw, which is a real jewel in our crown and somewhere that should be further promoted. The introduction of cooperation tax at 12.5% in 2018 will be a vital lever available to us, and certainly InvestNI need the right support and resources to prepare for this new tool which is coming towards us. Promoting Northern Ireland around the world through trade missions is a very valuable way of selling this country and attracting foreign direct investment, and also broadening the horizons of our existing business. Having spoken to a number of small local businesses who have been working with InvestNI on trade missions, they really value these trips, and which has allowed them to grow their export base, develop their business and ultimately create jobs. Developing our apprenticeships are also vital, and building on the work between our universities, our colleges and schools, and developing the STEM subjects. Research and development is another key ingredient to growing our economy and creating jobs. Our thriving agri-food sector, and in this year of food and drink, is another example of a vital sector with even more potential. We also need to get the right infrastructure in place, and that has been mentioned several times today, investing in our roads, transport networks, and ensure that we are connected to the rest of the world through broadband and better mobile coverage, particularly in rural areas. Despite the challenges to our economy, we must redouble our efforts, improve our economic competitiveness to grow our private sector, rebalance our economy, and ultimately get more and more people out of unemployment queues and into real and lasting jobs. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I think we've had a very useful debate, and I would now summarise some of the points that have been made with enthusiasm. With Conor Murphy, who spoke as the Chair of the Economy Committee, made the point that we do need to focus on the programme for government on job creation. And as Chair, he will be working with members of the committee to develop a strategy on our economy. Steve Aiken, it is Steve Aiken, I understand. Good. Recognised the value of our universities and colleges and the need to upgrade skills, especially amongst our young people. Mr Lunn also recognised the needs for skills upgrade, had some concern about the future as a strong base of manufacturing and our access to markets, and also he recognises the need for supporting further investing opportunities with the new introduction of cooperation tax and the benefits that will flow from that. Mr Buchanan made the points about the need for upgrading skills and the gaps that are within our young people and within the workforce. He talked about our young people. The young people of today in our schools and colleges are the workforce of tomorrow. Mr Lyons recognised the good work of the executive in meeting targets and, in fact, exceeding targets through InvestNI in the previous mandate. Mr Eastwood mentioned the need for more jobs in Londonderry. I believe he said Londonderry, just can't remember. But I would remind him that 70% of manufacturing is carried outside of Belfast. Emma Little Pengelly made the points about South Belfast. It sounded very like North Down that she was talking about, but talked about the educational excellence and the mix of underachievement, the need for growing the economy, the need for high-value jobs and addressing educational underachievement. Alan Chambers made his maiden speech, made it well, recognised the needs of the North Down area. As a representative, fully endorsed that, the need for more workspace and for the need to develop apprenticeships. Mr McCrossan, I think, was the most negative of all. All I would say is that it would be difficult, I think, to attract new investors or new visitors even to an area having such a negative record being put forward. I think, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, we've had a very useful debate. I think a lot of good points have been made, and I hope we'll move forward on it. Thank you very much.
The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it.